Good evening, everyone. We'll call the meeting to order. Joy, would you please call the roll?
Flournoy.
Here.
Hallie.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Thompson.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Additions to this evening's agenda, Council? I would like to make one. We are going to see if it would be possible to reset the council meeting that is scheduled for the 12th to the 15th. And we'll discuss that in our action items section, so I'll add that to the agenda. And then we'll move to our consent agenda, where we have approval of minutes from the November 14th council meeting, approval of the November 18th payroll of $120,200.98, the acceptance of our library board minutes, approval of liquor licenses for La Hacienda and Flamingo Lanes, and then also approval of claims in the amount of $236,795.65, of which our large claim will be to J&L Construction, $93,910, and that was a water main project along Liberty Drive. Entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Moved by Thompson.
Second.
Second by Rasmussen. Any discussion, Council? Not, please call the roll.
Thompson.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Hallie.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Flournoy.
Yes, abstaining from the number 14 minutes.
Okay, thank you. I guess we'll move on to our resolutions and action items. And the first is considering a policy for public records requests. And I'm going to ask our city clerk to explain the policy to us, and something we don't have in place right now, but we do get these kinds of requests. Correct, Joy?
Correct. Yeah, we receive several requests for either public inspection or copies, and we've never had a formal policy. We always kind of look at each other and say, you know, how much do we charge, and no one really knows. And so we just wanted to put it in writing, and so every staff member can have a copy. It's all spelled out, the cost per page, if it's black and white or if it's color. And it also gives the person that's making the request, we can anticipate how much time it's going to take to receive those copies. And the person that comes in will fill out the request form, and then we keep a copy. So we just wanted it documented so we have something in writing.
Thanks, Joy. And Joy, just for the public, since they don't have a copy of the document, give us an example of the photocopy charges.
For a single-sided copy, an 8.5 by 11 is 30 cents a page. If it's double-sided, it's 35 cents a page. For a color copy, 35 cents a page. Double-sided, 40 cents a page.
Okay, and then so, you have the estimated time of response. So if someone comes in and they would like something done, is it up?
Yeah, it goes up to 10 full business days if it's a large request. Actually, 20 full business days for 1,000 pages requested. And then after that, 10 full business days per additional 1,000 pages. But if somebody just wants, like, maybe 5 pages, it's where the anticipated time is 3 business days.
Okay.
And we do receive several requests for this. It takes, you know, time from the staff to make the copies, and so we just wanted it.
But our intention is to do them as soon as possible. It's just if there's other work ahead of it, then.
Exactly.
Council, any questions on the proposed policy?
I think it's a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I'll take that as a motion.
I accept that.
Is there a second by Flournoy? Any other discussion? Not all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thanks. But Council, because we are kind of resetting some of the things that we have in motion for some of the major financing that we have coming up, We need to push the December 12th meeting back to the 15th. We wanted to see if you would be available potentially at noon on the 15th. I know John will not be, so he's away for an extended period of time. Michael, you're good. Katie, you know if you can.
As soon as I can get off the phone, I'll get over here.
Okay.
Time.
I cannot make it.
Cannot.
I can be here at that time. Okay. We're still having the special council meeting at 7 on the 5th, and
yes.
then we're still having our regular meeting on the 19th.
Yes.
No. Oh. No, this would just be, Mayor, the 5th and the 15th.
Okay.
Yep.
Just so we won't have the regular meeting on the 19th, correct?
No.
As we said.
No.
Correct.
We only have one in December normally.
Right. Yeah.
And it was going to be the 12th. And then we sent an extra one on the 5th.
Okay, so then that's good news. So it would be the 15th, but that time.
Yes.
The 15th,
yep.
though.
At noon on the 15th.
Will the business on the 15th just be limited to that business, or are we going to be taking regular business? Because that may be an issue for some people and their how much time they have available during
right.
that time.
We would have a consent agenda for claims. Okay. We would also have the public hearing on the plans and specs for the wastewater treatment facility, as well as the plans and specs for the acceptance of the what we're going to call the interceptor running through the Fairfield right. Golf and Country Club.
Okay.
Those are the two primary agenda items, as well as a consent agenda for that particular meeting.
So I would say fine, as long as our meeting on the 5th, if there's any other regular December business that we get it on,
yeah.
as much of it on that.
Yeah, yeah. We can certainly do that.
Okay. So it looks like we'll have a quorum, and then if Katie can, she will. If not, we can maybe get her to call in if we need her.
Okay. I just may show up a little late.
Sure.
It'll be as soon as I can hang up on a customer.
Good.
Okay. So I'd entertain a motion then to reset our December 12th meeting to December 15th at 12 noon.
So moved.
Moved by Thompson.
Second.
Second by Rasmussen. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next, council, we want to set a public hearing for sidewalk repair. Schedule of assessment, and this is for 104 North Court Street, which is the property of where Timely Solutions just completed their work. We will set that public hearing for December 5th. When?
Right. You know, we could do
5th?
The 5th, Mayor.
Yeah.
That would be
okay.
fine.
So we'll change it to the 5th at 7 p.m. So entertain a motion then to set the public hearing for December 5th.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson.
Second.
Second by Flournoy. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next, council, we have a five-year agreement for maintenance and road repair of our primary roads with the Department of Transportation. I'm going to ask our street superintendent. Is he here? Darrell?
Yeah.
He's not. Mike, you may have to take this one.
Sure,
first.
I'll take it, Mayor. Thank you, Mayor. So the agreement that's before you is our five-year maintenance agreement with DOT. Daryl has reviewed this. The other departments have reviewed this. There are no changes to this agreement as written from the previous 5 years. However, it does require council approval. Basically, it spells out what the Department of Transportation, their responsibilities are in terms of maintaining our roads, plowing the snow on the state highways, and that type of thing. And then it lays out what our responsibilities are for city crossings, right-of-ways, and so on and so forth in terms of both street structural repair and of maintenance and snow removal. So again, nothing changed from the practice of the previous 5 years. This is simply a renewal of what we have had in the past.
Okay. Any questions, council, on the agreement? Not entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Moved by Flournoy.
Second.
Second by Thompson. Any discussion? Not, please call the roll.
Flournoy.
Yes.
Thompson.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Hallie.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Abstain because of my employment with the Iowa Department of Transportation.
Okay, thank you. Next item, council, is the approval of North Campus Village Phase 5 TIF indebtedness, and I can understand we will table this for this evening?
That's correct, Mayor. I'd recommend to this council that we table this indefinitely. Our development agreement with the, with Martin Brett indicates that he'll be responsible for legal fees. Some development agreements, we incur the tax, or we collect the tax from the TIF and spend those dollars for the legal fees. In this particular agreement, Mr. Brett is responsible for them upfront. So we will pay the cost of the legal fees and then be reimbursed by Mr. Brett.
Okay. All right, so then we'll move on to the public hearing on the matter of annexing a portion of North Campus Village Phase 5. This, again, was a very small piece of property that the university, I believe, is deeding over and will be a part of this Phase 5 project. So we'll open the public hearing at this time and ask if there is any public comment on the annexation proposal. Not seeing any comment, we'll close the public hearing, and we'll move on to a resolution considering the annexation of this portion of land. I think, council, you have a map reminding you of where that portion is. Any other information the council will need, Mike?
Yeah, I don't think so. I would certainly entertain any questions, Mayor. You're looking at a map of Phase 5. The particular portion in question is this sliver of Granville Road that was currently in the county that Martin would like to include as part of his development. So the piece in question is sort of this shaded area that was included in your packet. That is the piece that's up for possible annexation tonight, council.
Okay, thank you. Any questions? Not entertain a motion to approve the request for annexation?
Move to approve.
Second.
Moved by Hamilton, second by Anderson. Any discussion? Not, please call the roll.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Flornoy?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And then next, we have a public hearing for the plans and specifications that we had discussed this a little bit earlier. This is really one of the reasons why we are pushing our meeting from the 12th back to the 15th. So this item will be postponed to the meeting on the 15th. So this is what we will have under consideration at that time, so we will take no action. Let's see, so let's take a motion to postpone the public hearing until our meeting on December 15th, please.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Rasmussen, second by Thompson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Did I forget a step, Mike?
It's okay.
Okay. We have a public hearing on the matter of authorizing our loan agreement and issuance of $24,995,000 for our sewer revenue capital loan notes with the USDA. So we will open the public hearing at this time. If there's any public comment on this expenditure on behalf of the city. Okay. Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing. Mike, can you tell us what our resolution this evening is going to be accomplishing?
Absolutely. Thank you, Mayor. This resolution establishes our authority via federal and state law to borrow $24,995,000 in conjunction with the construction of our wastewater treatment facility. So there are a number of items in the resolution that this particular borrow authorizes: acquisition, construction, reconstruction, extending, remodeling, improving, repairing, and equipping all or part of the municipal sewer utility, and acquisitions and construction of an equalization basin, new pumping and headworks processes, a new oxidation ditch, a new aerobic digester and UV disinfection system, rehabilitation of the existing oxidation ditches, related sewer system improvements, related site improvements, and any refunding of outstanding project notes with accrued interest thereon and payment for said project. So it's a fancy way of saying everything that we need to accomplish with the upgrade and construction of our wastewater treatment facility and the preliminary costs we incurred for land acquisition, engineering, design, Those are all reimbursable with this borrow. So this public hearing or this resolution allows us to move forward with the borrow on this project, Mayor.
Okay. Thank you, Mike.
You're welcome.
Who would like to be the first to approve the largest borrowing?
I would move to approve this.
Second. Moved by Hamilton, second by Flournoy. It's just such a big amount. It seems like it deserves a drum roll or something.
I don't know. It's a necessity.
It is a necessity. Yeah, and it is, it's a good result and a good outcome also. And it's going to be a great project long-term for the city of Fairfield. Any other discussion? Not, please call the roll.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So, Council, next several items are approving what you considered in your closed session last time as agreements with property owners for either land acquisition or easements in each of these different cases. So we will take them one at a time here. So first resolution will be for the property at 2060 Libertyville Road, and that is Larry and Nancy Swain, total of $1,600.
Move to approve.
Second.
Moved by Hallie, second by Flournoy. Discussion? Not, please call the roll.
Hallie?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Thank you. Next will be for Huffman Estates, and this is for a total of $100. And again, this is along Libertyville Road.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson.
Second.
Second by Thompson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Next will be for parcel 2070 on Libertyville Road, William and Ida Wyatt, for a total of $370.
So moved.
Moved by Flournoy, second by Anderson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Our next will be property at 2078 Libertyville Road, and that is Mark and Tamara Merrill, total of $2,140.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay. Moved by Hamilton, second by Thompson. Discussion? Please call the roll.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
And then the property at 2059 Libertyville Road, belonging to Myrna Gilpin, a total of $11,470.
Move to approve.
Moved by Rasmussen.
Second.
Second by Hamilton. Discussion? Please call the roll.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. We'll move on to action item, and this is a legal services agreement authoring our city attorney, Marcy Law, on, and this will be, I'll ask council to approve an amendment here. The language says step two of sanitary service conveyance improvement project. This is actually the wastewater treatment project. So in terms of amendment, we would change that from the wastewater treatment project.
So moved with amendment.
Okay. Moved by Anderson to approve. Second by Hallie. Any discussion? Not all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. Thank you. Now we move to our ordinance council. We have the third and final reading for the TIF indebtedness associated with the Phase 5 North Campus Village project. And this again will allow for a special fund for payment of principal interest on loans or money or indebtedness taken by this project. This is a public hearing, so we'll declare the public hearing open at this time and ask if there's any public comment. Seeing none, we'll close the public hearing. And we'll move on to our third and final reading.
So moved.
Moved by Hamilton to approve third and final reading.
Second.
Second by Flournoy. Any discussion? If not, please call the roll.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Council, we'll move on to our second reading of Ordinance 1146, and that would be the lodging house regulations reading, and this is to repeal and replace what we have on right now, and this is the work that's been done by the committee looking at the short-term rentals Airbnb. This is also a public hearing. I'll open the public hearing at this time and ask if there is any comment on the proposed ordinance. Yes, sir.
Yes. Thank you. I just got the permit for Airbnb. Thank you. And then there is a question about rooming house. That's the type which I asked for because that's what corresponds with Airbnb. And I discussed the wording very briefly with Rebecca this afternoon. On rooming house, on second page, it says that it cannot be used for cooking or eating purposes, which we think means that a rooming house is not a house where you provide, you cook food and you serve food. But we do have a kitchen in that apartment and people can use the kitchen. So according to what Rebecca told me, she thinks that it means we don't provide like restaurant type or brand and breakfast, we don't. But people can cook and they can eat. So what I would like to propose is that the wording be edited, if this is true, that the wording be edited so that there is no ambiguity, and then people can use the kitchen in an Airbnb unit. I actually have 2 points.
Okay. So everyone see the section that Francis is referring to?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Any comments, Council?
We could I just think it's
strike,
a good point.
You
just strike the but not for cooking or eating purposes.
Would it fall under one of the other definitions?
What is the?
Or we could say not for cooking or food service. The intent is that the homeowner does not prepare the food, but the occupant can, right?
The homeowner does not prepare food, but the guests can. They can eat.
Mm-hmm.
They can cook. This is in the definitions paragraph, the very beginning.
I have a question that I'd like to direct to our attorney, Mr. Morris.
Sure.
Health code inspections involving food being prepared by either the owner in this situation, do they have to comply with the state code when it comes to having an inspection of that food service that would be going on if the owner was providing food for the tenants in a rooming house situation?
Scott might know as much as I don't believe they have to.
Ours is just in the bed and breakfast section of the code, and the state does all the inspections. We don't inspect those. The state inspects those.
Okay, so how would this work crosswise with rooming house versus bed and breakfast?
Well, like he said,
the rooming house, the food isn't prepped by the owner.
Right. The tenant's doing the kitchen's available to them. They do their own cooking. The cooking's not done for them. Whereas the bed and breakfast, they do the cooking for you.
Mm-hmm.
They have breakfast for you in the morning. You make your own in this. If the stuff's available for you, you make your own.
Okay. I guess I don't see what precludes someone from applying for a rooming house and not saying that they're not going to prepare, or saying that they're not going to prepare something, but then it happens. You know, what if there is a complaint that arises from it, somebody prepares them some food and the lodger gets sick, comes back on the owner, then it's found out that this happened to be because food was prepared for them, but that didn't fit the regulation that we've outlined. You know, I'm just trying to figure out if there's something that's going to hook us on this for taking away that line.
I don't believe so. I don't think we can be held liable for our inspection.
John, can you come to the microphone, please?
Thank you. Our inspections are intended for public safety purposes, mm-hmm. but we're usually not warranting what we inspect, if you understand.
We're in
to make sure that the criteria have been met. That doesn't mean somebody can take the battery out of their smoke alarm after Scott said it's okay. That doesn't mean that somebody can't cook up a really unhealthy substance at a bed and breakfast, even though we think it's a great bed and breakfast on inspection. And mm-hmm. we basically aren't held to warranting when we're doing inspection for our legitimate public safety inspection purpose. We can't be there all the time. That's kind of what the problem is with the question about the distinction between the rooming house and the bed and breakfast, mm-hmm. is there's really no way for Scott to know
what the difference
really is.
After he's made
an inspection, what's going to happen the next day, mm-hmm. as far as who might choose to cook something versus, you know, tenant versus the owner being the cook. I guess we can try to explain that by giving a copy of our ordinance, and it probably would be understood by the owner, but it's going to be hard for Scott to catch it.
Okay.
John, do you have a recommendation on where to start and end the strike here?
It was actually, my copy came apart. If you've got it here. Yeah, okay. All right, and you're talking about the not yeah. for cooking or eating.
Yes. So that they can cook, they can eat without us doing it.
And can you just add cooking, since you're going to allow for it? Just it's to be used for living, sleeping, and cooking purposes.
I suppose, yeah, you could just on a rooming house just take out the but not for and just say for cooking or eating, and then maybe parentheses only if not by owner.
Then it gets a little muddy as to why it's not going to be a bed and breakfast.
Exactly.
If we're going to start cooking.
Yeah, it is muddy.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if it's going to be a rooming house, that's one thing. But if they're going to do food and things, then it becomes a bed and breakfast.
So why do
really?
We even have it then?
I mean,
he's describing that he has an apartment that is seeking approval as a rooming house that has a kitchen.
When we travel Airbnb, part of the attraction
is that
I can
boarding
cook.
House. Right, it comes under the boarding house. Why do we even have rooming house in there? Yeah, if we've got this, I mean, if it's not plain to us, it's not plain to them. Why do we even have it?
When we travel Airbnb, one of the attractions for me is that we don't spend money at restaurants. I can cook for my family there.
Okay.
I don't expect you, the homeowner, to cook the meals for my family.
Okay.
But you have a kitchen, right. And I can cook.
Okay, but then it's either a boarding house or. Right?
According to this, a boarding house, the meals are provided.
You pay for them.
And you pay for them
for compensation.
I'm going to go to the rooming house so I can cook for my own family. But somehow we need to word it so it's understood that the homeowner isn't cooking them.
In your stay as a rooming house, was okay. this a place where the kitchen was still used by the people that were living in the house, or were you just the sole occupants of this place?
We're the sole occupants of that floor, which had a kitchenette.
Okay.
But you did not use the kitchen.
No, I did. That's the
you
whole reason we stay Airbnb is so I can cook for my family.
Okay, you did use the kitchen. Okay.
Mike, if I may. Maybe a clarifier, yeah.
I'm wondering if we add, but not for commercial cooking or eating purposes, and then define what we mean by commercial. That's, it's a thought.
That might be a little bit better from the standpoint that, you know, preparing food – somewhere in an environment where it's the only kitchen in a house that has two rooms upstairs that they're going to use for Airbnb and still occupy the home themselves as the owner there. I've never used Airbnb, and I don't know whether people just leave their house for someone else to come in and do everything, but not be there while they're there. This doesn't sound like that's that type of situation. You have another room that's got its own kitchen that's away from your living area in the home, and you want them to be able to use that as if it is a separate living unit altogether.
It's an independent, self-sufficient unit.
Why isn't it an apartment?
Is yeah.
Is it just the length of time they're going to be there?
Yep. Okay. That's what defines it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And also the way they book using the Airbnb service.
I know at Muddy's boarding house, I'm thinking back to Martha's question, but I'm not sure, maybe we don't want to say after, in the definition for boarding house, after for compensation by the owners anyway. And that is going to get referenced back to, from rooming house to what you do at boarding house, and it's going to show that owners prepare it at the boarding house. And that's clearly what we expect to be going on. And there would be a reason if you apply for a boarding house permit that Scott would probably look your facility over for that possible use there. Not with the rooming house, if it's all going to be done with people that don't have any expectation of cooking for pay being served to them. I think Mike's suggestion about the word commercial after, but not for commercial cooking or eating, would help clarify too, but I don't know how else to make it much.
Well, unless it falls under that short-term rental, which is anything that's less than 28 consecutive days. Say I rent it for 2 days. Isn't that a short-term rental rather than a rooming house?
Mm-hmm.
And then it would allow me to do all of those types of things in that particular unit.
I'm trying not to make it one of those for Scott.
Well, yeah, I'm trying not to do that too.
That's where we put it in there, though, was the fact it was for living and sleeping, but not for eating.
If we can help by adding a word or two, I'd say let's do it.
So
we're not warranting what we expect after the idea that we feel it's safe for what's being presented. And at that point, you know, if somebody wants to change the game the next day, we're not going to probably be around to know that that changed until the next time the permit comes up. So we don't want anything unsafe to happen, but we don't have a way to monitor all the time.
So then is it acceptable to insert commercial to clarify the concern that's being brought before us now, since I think that's what he's describing, is it would be utilized but not by the owner and not for commercial purposes?
I think it helps.
Okay. Uh-huh. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And the second question I have is about the same unit, in fact, that we would like to have the freedom to sometime use with Airbnb and sometime not use with Airbnb. For instance, we do not want to exclude long-term renters. In that case, we don't use Airbnb, we use our regular rental contract. So I want to make sure that if we have the authorization to use this as a rooming house, we may stop using it as a rooming house whenever we please and then turn it into a long-term. Financially, you get the same. Long-term rental or Airbnb, as far as our apartment is concerned, we would get the same. But some people, they want to do it for long-term. Long-term is not well taken care of with Airbnb. So we don't want to be obligated to do Airbnb.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems to me that Here it is not really clear whether I can do rooming house for Airbnb and then one day close it and say, no, it's not Airbnb, no, it's, this gentleman is going to stay for 6 months, for instance. And the place where I saw that is because a rooming house can be used for no more than 28 days, as you just said recently. But the unit needs to be considered also outside that context of rooming house when we decide to use the other way to do it.
I don't think we're trying to define anything outside of just these parameters, so I don't think you really have any concern. I mean, when you are utilizing it in its short-term, for short-term purposes, then you're governed by this. But outside of that, you're not.
And we're going to get into trouble on this, and the definitional code sections in there have to do with when it's going to be required to know that this is applicable to hotel-motel tax.
Right.
Mm-hmm. If you switch from one to the other, it's going to be on you as far as keeping in shape with the Iowa Department of Revenue. We will probably have our records scrutinized by Iowa Department of Revenue because they're public records, and if we've got 50 people that are Airbnb, somebody at the Department of Revenue will take a look sometime after we've been up with our ordinance for months or a year or so. And at that point, if you look like you should be paying hotel motel tax, and you made a decision 6 or 7 months back to have a long-term lease with a tenant that has nothing to do with Airbnb, that's on you as far as how you keep track of that. And we aren't going to know it in our records unless you indicate to City Hall that you might want to have Scott come back out and inspect me as an apartment because I'm not the same as I was last year at this time. So that's about all we can do, to try to stay in the perimeter of what we need to let exist with hotel motel tax and still have you be able to make multiple uses that you'll have to distinguish if there's a question about whether you owe that state tax or not. And then we also have our own hotel motel tax on top of that here in town. So we're going to be just as anxious to know what you resolve with Iowa Department of Revenue because we're the second layer, so to speak. Okay?
I was under the impression that rooming houses do not pay hotel and motel taxes according to those ordinances, or did I misread?
The short-term rentals fall under that.
Short-term rentals. Yeah. What about rooming house? Is the rooming house supposed to be paying hotel taxes? I didn't get that.
I don't read it.
From here. I didn't get that rooming houses were going to pay hotel and motel taxes.
Well, what's the legal definition of a short-term rental according to the state of Iowa?
Short-term rentals are rentals which are ordinarily not governed by or subject to the Iowa Uniform Residential Landlord-Tenant Act.
Yeah, so less than 28 days is no.
Well, every type that's listed in the definitions would be defined as short-term. So they would all be they would all collect hotel motel taxes.
Right. I believe so. I believe that
right.
That's
and
what
then
this
it goes
ordinance
on.
Is,
section
short-term.
B talks about that being uh-huh. Short-term rentals are understood for the purpose of this ordinance to include lodging defined in the Iowa Code 423A.2 lodging for purposes of imposition of state and locally imposed hotel motel tax are subject to exemptions. Set forth. So
it doesn't say you're being taxed here, it just says whatever the state requires is what you have to do. Mm-hmm. Are you exempt if it's 28 days or less from the motel hotel tax? It doesn't say in there specifically.
No, it says that the public measure A in November 6th of 2001 adopted a 7% local hotel motel tax.
Right, if it's applicable to this definition. From here, I can't tell whether his unit would be applicable.
Or not. Well, yes.
Well, it would when he's renting it for less than 28 days. Yeah. But when it's not, it's not.
That's the whole purpose of having these in the first place.
Right.
Exactly.
Yeah, so I think by definition, everything that's in this ordinance is, if it falls within that, those parameters, a short-term rental would be subject to the hotel motel tax.
So what we mean by rooming house also falls under short-term rentals?
Yes.
Yes, right.
And this is something that is not under our power in the city? It comes from the state?
No, this is something that we're adopting by law.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So we are adopting it?
Right.
Is it already decided upon, or is it open to discussion?
We're in the same
Well, yeah, that's what we're doing tonight.
That's what we're doing tonight.
Yes.
And what I would like to briefly say is that Airbnb, which I've used for 4 years already in maybe 6 different countries so far, makes places attractive. And it makes it more attractive to the owners, to be more attractive to the visitors. I know it might be a bit naive, but I thought it would make my point.
That's fine. We call that here a non-starter.
All right. Yes.
Thank you anyway, Francis.
Thank you.
No, and we appreciate that. I think you can debate whether it's a disincentive, but I think more and more communities are trying to also balance the playing field between those commercial establishments that are required to, and yet they have short-term rentals, and their tenants are paying the hotel motel tax, and it just it's part of the reason why we're moving forward with it too. Thanks. Yes.
Another question, point of clarification under application fees. It doesn't say how frequently those application fees will be applied. Is that an annual fee of both the $80 and the $30? Is it every third year? Is what?
This is the top of page 4.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The way I read it is the application fee is paid at time of application, and then two sections down, it's paid again at renewal.
It says here $80 every per year for the first unit and $30 for each additional unit.
Yes.
Per year.
That's where it reads.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
It says it right there.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry. I didn't understand that.
Yeah, it's okay.
So the $30 per unit, is that where did that number come from? Is that what the hotels pay for per unit for their inspections? Is that?
This isn't an inspection fee. This is the application to run a business out of your home.
Okay.
So this has nothing to do. This is unrelated to the inspection.
The $80. Okay, so right. There'll be another inspection fee from Scott.
$4 years.
$80 every 4 years from you, and $80 just one time to start my Airbnb?
The way this reads, it's $80 per year.
For one unit. One unit. And then each unit that you have in the house, if you have three units in there, it'd be 80 plus 30 and 30. So it'd be $140 for your year to run a three-room Airbnb.
Plus $80 to him.
For every 4 years for the inspection, as far as rental property inspection is concerned.
Okay.
The Katie's point that this is designed to be a fee for you to run your business out of your home, I'm just wondering if it should be more in alignment with the home occupation permit.
I have this all marked up for tonight. And
okay. So you have that comment to make.
The
okay.
fees were one of them. I feel like okay. this is fiscally burdensome to those who are trying to do this. And I mean, I can only use myself as an example, but if I were trying to do this out of my own home and trying to get up and going and, you know, paying inspection fees and passing, you know, permits for the state and permits for the city, and then to hunk this on top of it, I feel like it's kind of burdensome. So right now, I believe we charge $50 for an in-home business. Is that correct?
Yeah.
It's a home occupation permit.
Home occupation permit.
Right. $50 annually?
Yes.
It is.
So, and that's
for... This is 80 plus 30
And
plus
that's 30. That's for a business that operates without employees coming back and forth from the house. It also... restricts parking, number of vehicles that can be at the residence concerning business transactions. and those types of things, which are different from what an Airbnb would be in my definition of it, because a home occupation is someone that's running maybe an internet business out of their home, and they'll have a UPS truck coming every once in a while, but they don't have, you know, six people show up to be there for 3-4 days and then leave. So the idea that $80 plus if you have two more rooms being $140 a year seems to me a little erroneous when you move it to a $50 a year fee, because you're going to make quite a little bit more money than that $140 annually. Otherwise, you wouldn't run the business at all.
But so would the business owner that only paid 50. Mm-hmm.
The business owner that only paid 50, we had a couple of complaints on that. That $50 was too high for their business. One was offering piano lessons. And the other one was just taking photographs for passports. So both of them, I don't know whether they renewed their home occupation permits or not. And I was contacted by both of them at the time that we went from $10 a year with that to $50 a year with home occupation. Now, a majority of those people that have the home occupation permits that renew them every year never had any problem with that going up that way at all. So I still believe that if you rent two units every month, once or twice a month, and you get $50 or $100 from those two units, say you get $50 each one, if you do that for twice a week for a month, and all of the months of the year, 12 months of the year, you're going to have more money than what we're requiring. And I believe that in a Airbnb that's run just for having people come in and go out in a short-term situation, you're going to get a little higher turnover than that, I would think. Otherwise, you wouldn't want to do it as just a business by itself.
Right. Well, this is a fairly rural area. We do get a lot of outside visitors coming in, but this is not New York City. This ain't Manhattan.
No, it's not.
And so the income is you're making it sound like it's ginormous, and it's clearly not. There are times when there are more visitors, and that's when I like to have an Airbnb open, because then the extra people that come to town do have a really friendly place to stay. But yeah, it just, I just wondered how the comparisons, how things compared. Are we setting these fees based on what hotel motels pay for their inspections and per unit? Are we setting them based on what a home, and it sounds to me like it's more than double all of the other fees that anybody else is paying to do anything.
Well, a hotel would be paying commercial property tax, first of all, which is about twice what, you know, residents okay. would be paying. So I think that's where, you know, they're paying more. We're not doing inspections in hotels.
State
mm-hmm. So that's not our purview. But I mean, I take your point, but I think there are differences between commercial and residential permission.
Well, but we're blurring that line with Airbnb.
Right. I'd rather keep this a simpler discussion on whether $80 and $30 is the right fee structure, and I'll just ask the council what they feel about that.
Well, I guess
sure.
From my standpoint, I don't mean we won, but so basically, and I'm not trying to pin you down to anything, but anybody that's talking about the fees, I guess my first question is, so what does that do to your rates? Does that take your rates from $50 a night, or whatever you're charging? Does it raise from $10 a night, $20 a night?
Well,
no. Just what does it raise? Are you going to have to raise your fees an astronomical amount in order to cover $140?
I'd probably go up $10.
Okay. So any of these people coming here, if you're telling me they're coming here for that, they're not going to pay an extra $10?
Keep in mind, you're now being required to report to the state too for hotel motel.
One of the blessings with Airbnb is that they keep track of all that for us.
Okay.
They keep track of how many days and how much income we've had. And actually, Airbnb, my customer who would be coming to stay at my place now will be charged 12%. Is that what I saw in taxes? That has they haven't been to this point charged by anyone else in this municipality. And now we're adding fees. And so those of us that are doing it have to recoup those fees somehow. And
sure.
So what is that on a $50 a night stay? 12% plus 10 more dollars? What does that come to? Another 15?
$16.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. Exactly.
Yeah. If it's $10, I mean, would you really raise your rates $10 on every rental for an $80 fee? I think that that's probably high.
It's really not just 80. It's 80 and 30 and 30.
Right. Okay. But if you amortize it out, or how many stays would you have in a year?
You know, this has been a really weird year, so I can't really answer
is it
that
over,
right now.
Is it over or under 50?
I'd like it to be more than 50.
But let's say it's 40. Okay, so.
That's $3.50 a stay.
Right.
Uh-huh.
You might only raise your rates $3 to $4 based on fees.
But I guess my point is the travels I've done. The idea of when you pull into someplace and if you really like this, people are coming here because they like that. If the difference between $50 and $66 means that they're going to go someplace else, they probably shouldn't be traveling in the first place.
Well, and the other thing too is just to give a little history also, you know, when the whole the hotel motel tax issue first came up, and Fairfield wasn't collecting it, you know, we had all of the business owners, you know, come before us and say, you know, you're going to close my business, nobody's going to pay this. The point is, they pay it everywhere they go, and nobody looks at the tax, you know, structure, and we're just basically. And those dollars have really helped us create a tourism industry in Fairfield, very important to us, and they're going to continue to be. And I think the charm of our community and the opportunity for people to stay in a short-term rental Airbnb is not going to be unduly influenced by price. I understand that part of the makeup of the Airbnb customer is that somebody is looking for something that's a little bit less cost. But I wouldn't say it's everybody. I would say it's probably a mix of people who are looking for the bargain as opposed to looking for the experience. So,
if John were here, which he's not, he would want to see them in line with home occupancy permit, which I feel more comfortable with because it's something that we've got set.
Maybe we need to raise those.
We just raised them recently.
Yeah.
This isn't where the city is going to make its money. We're already asking or requiring them to collect hotel motel and then add a higher fee than what we ask other businesses operating other homes. To me, it does seem unfair. It does seem arbitrary. I don't know where 80 and 30 came from. 50 and 20 to me makes more sense. 50 at least is something we can point to is what we charge other people running business out of their homes. 80 just seems...
Yeah, that came from the task force, and that probably came from an ordinance that they had pulled from some other place that seemed very comparable and reasonable to what another city that supposedly is near our size in Iowa, mm-hmm. which this was lot based on.
Let's ask Martha, do you know where those... Was it discussed there, or was it something else?
We did discuss it. I mean, you know, because, I mean, of course we looked at larger cities, and that's when we decided, you know, that's not feasible. I mean, and so we really considered, I think, the size of the community and what we were asking, and we felt that these were very fair charges. I mean, and in, you know, when we were looking at, you know, some of the other communities, I mean... So many of them wanted nothing to do with Airbnbs. I mean, Iowa City and even Ames, some of them are really struggling and sort of say, we're not getting into this. We're not going there. So, I mean, I think that we really had to kind of go out and say we felt that this was not these were not unreasonable fees to, you know, to require.
I would just ask my fellow council people if this is in line with our entrepreneurial spirit in Fairfield. And to me, this is prohibiting those who are trying to come up with means of running businesses on their own.
I think you got to be kidding me, aren't you? $140?
I'm not kidding you.
Well, the fee is to cover administrative costs. It's not a moneymaker for the city. So are we really expecting this is going to cost more than filing for a home occupancy permit? I mean, is it from a paperwork standpoint? Is this more involved, Mike? Would you comment on that? Is this more complex permit process than home occupancy?
I would say from the inspection standpoint, it's probably slightly more burdensome just given the number of rooms that could be involved. In terms of quantifying that, we could do that for you, council member, but we don't.
But that's a separate fee. This is a permit fee. Yeah. I'm asking if the permit process internally for the city staff is going to be about 60%, which is what this is, 60% more than our $50 fee. Is it really 160%?
I would say they're similar in terms of the time burden to process the actual permit.
I would propose an amendment to $50 annual fee and a $20 extra per unit just to be equitable with what we charge other businesses running out of their homes.
We charge extra for units.
Well, other home businesses don't pay extra for units.
So why are we doing that?
Yeah, good question.
Well, just one flat fee for a rental of any size.
Okay, so we're going to have two proposed amendments, and I'd like approval for the first amendment, which would be based on the language in the rooming house. Let's see.
Just to read, but not for commercial cooking, eating purposes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. John, actually, since we're actually amending the full ordinance, how would I go about taking these separately, or are we just good? Do we need to take both of them together?
I take them separate, and I refer to the 2058-10
right
section on rooming house, and I'd have somebody moving to just insert before the word for. Before the word cooking and after the word for in the second line of the rooming house definition, the word commercial, and someone just made that motion, didn't you?
Okay. So all right, so move by Anderson to insert the language for that clarifies rooming house. And it would say, but for commercial cooking or eating purposes.
But not for commercial. Commercial.
Okay.
Dot, dot, dot.
Joy,
you got that?
Mm-hmm.
If you're treating it as a friendly amendment, which I think was the gist to try to help better understand, I would say you don't have to worry about.
But our approval of this is just for language in that section.
Right.
Okay,
right.
Not for the full amendment, right. Not for the full ordinance.
Right.
Okay, so motion by Anderson. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Hallie. Any discussion on that point, Council? Not all those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed, the same sign? Thank you. And then the second proposed amendment would be, again, for the fees, the application fee, which currently is $80 per year for the first unit, $30 for the additional unit. We have a proposed amendment from Councilman Halley from $50 per year and $20 per unit.
So, and I would second that.
Okay, motion by Halley, second by Anderson. Discussion? Okay. Not, please call the roll.
Halley?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Thompson?
No.
Flournoy?
No.
Rasmussen?
No.
Hamilton?
No.
Okay. The motion is defeated. So then, Council, I would entertain a motion to approve the ordinance as amended from the second to the third reading.
I'm sorry, you had some more.
Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry, Katie.
On section 2058.040, the way it reads, I believe letter A and letter C contradict each other. And it's regarding the length of stay.
Length of stay.
What's C even doing in there?
Yeah, so C should be stricken.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. Kind of defeats the entire purpose of short-term rental by saying there's no maximum length of stay.
Right. So for the public, this is a section on length of stay, and in A, it says that the maximum length of stay is essentially 28 days occupancy, and C says there is no maximum length of stay.
So then I wanted to just tag onto that so you guys have a little more understanding. That four consecutive seven-day periods totaling 28 days. In the circumstance, and again, I'm pulling from my own family, when my husband travels for business, oftentimes with a client, it's a six-week stay. And so if we're trying to attract those business travelers into these type things, is that 28 stay renewable? Can it be renewed? I wonder if we wanted to add a renewable clause in there, or
I think when we discussed it, we felt that it was possible that it could be renewed. I mean, I think that we felt there weren't going to be that many instances where someone would be, you know, but if they were coming in for a project or something,
right.
They might
or a semester out at the school or something. I don't know if it needs to be clarified, Mr. Mayor, but I thought it might be something worth throwing out there. Is 28 days and I'm sorry you're out, or you can whatever, renegotiate for two more weeks.
Right.
Or
I think you could probably re-up under certain circumstances.
Okay.
Do we want language in there? Are you looking for language? One additional renewal period?
Well, this is just stating a total maximum, so shouldn't we, if we're going to extend that beyond 28 days, should just say it? Do we want to get to this renewal or extension, or do you just want to extend that to 6 weeks?
What is a semester if we brought in a professor?
I think 28 days was still kind of the standard that we were finding in a lot of other ordinances around the community. I think that's where we ended up, so I don't think we really want to add those days. But if
so, then we're back to A and B contradicting.
Okay.
A and C,
sorry.
Yeah. And if we strike C, there's no longer a conflict.
Thank you, Mayor. I could just speak to a little bit of the task force intent here. So the intent is that there are some squatter issues within Airbnbs, and so they wanted to regulate the maximum number of days somebody could stay in a short-term rental so that you would have those squatter issues. And legally, it's easier to get a tenant removed from your property if they're there less than the 30 or 29 day, I think, stated by law. In terms of C, I simply think there's a typo here, because we do have some long-term boarding houses and long-term rooming houses that exist within the city. So their thought was to include a provision that allowed for long-term rooming houses and long-term boarding houses. It's my belief that boarding house and rooming house should be struck from A.
Yeah.
From A?
That would be my, and Mayor, I'd yield the floor to Martha, but that was my understanding.
Right.
That would make it better.
Okay. Then if you strike it from A, then they no longer contradict each other.
Correct.
Okay.
And my husband can stay.
Okay. Other points?
I'm sorry, I got to ask this question. So when we were talking about the definitions, we said that boarding houses and rooming houses were short-term rentals, didn't we?
They can be.
They can be.
Okay. Right. So not necessarily.
Right. Not necessarily. Right.
So what we're saying in this ordinance is if they are used that way, then we want them to follow these rules, get these permits, collect hotel motel tax, but they can be used long-term, in which they would not be subject to this ordinance. Is that correct?
That's how I understood it.
Mayor, if I may?
Yes.
Still subject to the ordinance, but in terms of collecting hotel motel tax and some of those things, that change. But in terms of allowable use within a specific zone or the regulation and acquiring the permit to operate as a boarding house or rooming house. So still subject to all of those, just would vary in the collection of hotel motel tax.
So subject to portions of ordinance, just not the short-term
correct
rental portion.
That's correct.
Okay.
All right, and then my final point was under 20.58.130. It's a whole bunch of letters. On letter G, it says that fire and safety inspections will happen annually, and I did confirm with Scott that these are on a four-year rotating basis. Letter G.
Yes.
And then just so you know, I did give some grammatical corrections to Mike, and they don't change the content. They're, it's just the inner English.
Thank you.
Child we'll never of an know. English mother.
Thank you, Katie. So the proposal then would be to modify point G to be in line with our standard city code for inspections, which would be every 4 years. And then we would be going with Mike's explanation of the difference between usage of long-term and short-term boarding house and rooming house, which would lead us to eliminate from point A the words boarding house or rooming house. Okay, so entertain a motion to approve the second reading with those amendments.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay, moved by Hallie, second by Anderson. Any other discussion or questions, Council? Now, please call the roll.
Hallie?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Thompson?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. And thank you, everyone who contributed this evening. Next, Council, in the I just wanted to bring your attention. I did put at your desk the brand at a glance flyer that was distributed at the unveiling of the brand last week, which went quite well. So we look forward to seeing more usages around the community. This is a statement of some of the ways that it can be used and some of the explanations and answers that you have for people who are saying, why did we have that tree there with all the little funny circle leaves? Anyway, there's hopefully some useful information there. So we'll move down to our committee reports, property committee. Darren?
Yeah, the property committee met last week. We met with Betsy Howland.
Yep.
And she's the owner of Revelations. She had asked that there be two more changes be considered to the ordinance for outdoor dining. Currently, we're on the third reading, or would be on the third reading of that amendment, which was number 1144, ordinance number 1144. The committee asks that that be taken away from being postponed to being withdrawn so that the revision can be made to all three sections in one ordinance change rather than doing this ordinance change and then adding two more to it at a later date. The idea behind this is that we want to modify hours of alcohol service from 5 p.m. to 11 a.m. so that businesses that serve wine can do that during a lunchtime period or beer during a lunchtime period. And if they aren't open after 4 or such, they can still serve alcohol if they provide that. The other question was to how stringent the wording is for keeping the area clean. And it says that it should be kept clean at all times, the outdoor dining area. That language is a little strong in nature, and I haven't sent any recommendations back to the other committee members on that wording change. If they have any, then that would be something they could pass on to me. And then, of course, what we were looking at already in 1144 to go along with that.
Okay.
So I would like that the ordinance be changed in that direction rather than as doing it piecemeal.
Okay. John, procedurally, would you want us to a motion to withdraw the current And would we do it at this meeting or have that on an agenda for our next meeting?
I think you better go to the agenda.
Yeah. Okay. So we can do that, have both on the agenda for next time. You can have your first reading and also your withdrawal. Mm-hmm. Appreciate that. Thanks for your report. Mike, anything to report from your end?
Nothing, Mayor. Thank you.
Okay. Then we come to the end of the meeting. If there isn't any other business, I entertain a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Moved by Hamilton.
Second.
Second by Anderson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Meeting adjourned.